Malacañang pushing back against the claim of the resigned Defense Department OIC about the leadership change in the armed forces. The High Court jumps a 2005 agreement of the Philippines, China, and Vietnam for a joint marine seismic undertaking in the South China Sea. The World Bank slashes its growth forecast, warning the global economy is dangerously close to recession. And the low-pressure area off Surigao City bringing rains to the southern Philippines. Hi, I'm Carmina Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. Thanks for joining us. For those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, glad you could join us today. Our top story at this hour, the palace refuting a claim made by resigned acting defense chief Jose Faustino Jr. Faustino had said he quit after learning there's a new armed forces chief of staff, only from news reports and social media. But the presidential communications office insists Faustino knew of the reappointment of General Andres Centino. It adds a precedent as the commander-in-chief has the sole prerogative to appoint his military chief. Following Faustino's exit, at least seven senior defense officials have also tendered their courtesy resignations. Faustino's replacement, Carlito Galvez Jr., denies there is any issue with a sudden change of leadership in the agency. During his first briefing at the Defense Department Tuesday, Galvez said he has high regard for Faustino.
Pasangan beside ng president, hindi susunod dyan. And I was having sama parang exit briefings with Chair Faustino. Chair Faustino. And the president has high regard to him because he's a principled man. And I really appreciated very much yung very officer like na ginawa ni Chair Faustino na very high regards to him.
The armed forces of the Philippines likewise sees nothing irregular with the series of top-level changes in the defense sector. AFP spokesperson Colonel Medel Aguilar also defending a new law imposing a three-year term for AFP chiefs.
It is good for the armed forces of the Philippines, and General Centino believes in that also, and that he knows very well that this is a new law, and sometimes there are birth pains that we have to deal with. I don't think that the law is useless. I also believe in the wisdom of our legislators, and we also have to consider that the president is the commander-in-chief of the armed forces. He can choose or designate his chief of staff anytime, and of course according to his choice. It's about putting the right person on the right job and making adjustment along the way.
Colonel Aguilar also sees no reason to investigate the alleged destabilization plot within the military.
As far as the armed forces is concerned, there is a mission that we have to accomplish, and that's where our focus and our attention are looking to. So we don't want to be distracted. There is no need for an investigation inside the armed forces of the Philippines, because even after or during the change of command ceremony, we did not even raise our alert level. We maintained the alert level because everything was normal within the organization. We know that officers come and go.
In other news, more high-ranking police officials heed the call of Interior Secretary Benhur Abydos to submit their courtesy resignation in a bid to cleanse the ranks. The National Capital Region Police Office, or NCRPO, said all of its third-level officials have submitted themselves for evaluation. That's a total of 76 police colonels and staff ranks. NCRPO Chief General Jonel Estomo added 30 station commanders in Quezon City and Manila also agreed to undergo the process.
So parang ako personally, nung una, yung ayoko, nung narinig ko siya, nakinig ako sa kanya. I will follow the Chief PNP. Kaya ganyan din ang ginawa ko sa NCRPO, ako mismo. So lahat ng mga tao ko, hindi ko yan piniwersa. Sumama sila dahil ako mismo ay nag-submit na ng courtesy resignation.
Over in Eastern Visayas, 21 officers, including the region's director, have also submitted their courtesy resignations.
I explained to them na there's nothing to worry kasi there's nothing to hide. You just give your resignation, then let the committee decide. Kung tingin mo hindi tayo lalaban, we have social media, we have our law protect us. It becomes a challenge for us because the trust of our people nawawala kung hindi kami magsasabi po ng courtesy resignation.
The National Union of People's Lawyers calls for or make that calls former National Security Advisor Hermógenes Esperón's foiled complaint against 10 human rights activists baseless and flimsy. In 2019, Esperón filed a perjury case against leaders of Carapatan, Gabriela, and rural missionaries of the Philippines. He claimed the activists lied under oath in a 2019 writ of amparo petition that the groups filed against him, then President Rodrigo Duterte, and several other government officials. The rights defenders were acquitted earlier this week.
Yung immediate effect would be yung they felt the intimidation and harassment against them. Probably they will lose their liberty because of this. Overall, it shows what the government can do against this.
It's forced to evacuate their homes in eastern Visayas due to heavy rains and floods. Sharon Avita now joins us with that story. Sharon, go ahead.
Yes, Carmina. Hundreds of families fled their homes while classes remain suspended in some areas in eastern Visayas due to the incessant rain and flood. Though Tacloban City government did not issue an executive order suspending work and classes today, classes in elementary and high school were still canceled, as classes are automatically suspended in areas under red rainfall warning, based on the Department of Education's Order Number 37. Some areas in Tacloban are still flooded, like Suhi Village and VNG Subdivision. Around 12 families from Barangay 110 Utap evacuated to the Tacloban City Convention Center as floodwaters in their area reached neck deep. The family said they already received rice and canned goods as relief goods from the local government, but cooking them remains a challenge as their cooking utensils were left submerged in waters at their homes. Sharon Avita, ABS-CBN News.
Thanks a lot, Sharon Evite. And back here in the newsroom, the low-pressure area off Surigao City is unlikely to develop into a storm within 24 hours, but it will still bring rains to the southern part of the Philippines. Let's get more details now from ABS-CBN's resident meteorologist, Ariel Rojas. Ariel, over to you.
Hi, Carmina. The low-pressure area was last spotted 575 kilometers east of Surigao City, Surigao del Norte. As you've mentioned, the likelihood of this system developing into a tropical depression remains low in the next 24 hours, says PAGASA. Moderate to heavy rains are still expected over Mimaropa, Bicol Region, Visayas, and most of Mindanao. The LPA will continue its slow westward movement towards the Mindanao-Visayas area, persist until weekend and may dissipate by early next week. Flooding and landslides remain a threat, especially in areas that had significant antecedent rains since last week. Meanwhile, the northeast monsoon or Amihan continues to weaken, but we have still some low temperatures. In La Trinidad, Benguet, 12.2 degrees Celsius, and in Baguio City, 13.7 degrees Celsius this morning. Amihan will retreat by Thursday evening before surging back late Sunday. Metro Manila, meanwhile, will be sunny today with no chance of rain the entire day. That's the latest on the weather. Back to you, Carmina.
Thanks a lot, Ariel Rojas. Well, the Philippine Supreme Court strikes down a 2005 agreement of the Philippines, China, and Vietnam for a joint marine seismic undertaking in the South China Sea. The court voted 12-2. It said the deal is unconstitutional since it allowed wholly owned foreign corporations to participate in the exploration of the Philippines' natural resources. The court ruled on a 2018 petition filed by former Bayan Muna Party List representatives Satur Ocampo and Teddy Casino. They pointed out over one-sixth of the maritime area covered by the deal indisputably belongs to the Philippines. The 2005 tripartite deal ended in 2008, but Bayan Muna wanted the High Court to rule on the issues in the case ahead of any similar deal in the future. The Supreme Court ruling decision comes after President Marcos visited Beijing and expressed openness to discussing joint oil and gas exploration with China. Casino says the High Court's ruling should serve as a warning to Marcos. Well, Mr. Casino now joins us here on the program. He is a National Council member of the group Bayan. Teddy, good afternoon to you. Happy New Year and welcome to the program.
Happy New Year, Carmina. Happy New Year po sa lahat ng nakikinig.
All right. So this Supreme Court ruling coming out, Bayan calls this a major victory, but also says in the second breath that the battle is not over. Why do you say so?
Well, because joint exploration is still on the table with China. And with the visit of President Marcos recently to China to precisely push for joint exploration, this ruling becomes as relevant as ever, especially in our assertion that the West Philippine Sea is ours and that any exploration activities there should be under the control and supervision of the state and should involve only Filipino enterprises or Filipino companies.
How should this ruling now guide the talks that the Philippines will have with China?
I think it should strengthen the position of the Philippine government in line with the arbitral ruling on the West Philippine Sea, that any agreement we are to have with China or any entity for that matter that is interested in exploring or mining for oil and natural gas in the West Philippine Sea, it should abide by the Philippine Constitution because that area is within our economic zone. And rightfully, it should be under the supervision and control of the state, whatever economic activity that will happen there.
And as you say that, there is currently a move, Teddy, at the House of Representatives to explore the possibility of maybe removing that 60-40 rule. And if that happens, what do you think will be the scenario for the Philippines?
Well, changing the constitution will alter the whole thing because, of course, the ruling is based on the existing provision that says, this is Article 12, Section 2, that says that exploitation of natural resources is exclusive for Filipinos and only through entering with joint venture agreements or financial technical agreements with the state can private entities, Filipino-owned entities, be allowed to exploit our natural resources. If Congress or a constitutional convention decides against the 60-40 rule and says that it's now open house for everyone, that will, of course, change the whole environment and will make this ruling obsolete. But as of now, what we have is the current constitution, and that should be strictly followed. I guess in terms of negotiations, this ruling can be used as to buttress or support our argument that not only is it in the Constitution, but the Supreme Court itself has reiterated that position.
You know, one would think, Teddy, that, you know, the Constitution predates the 2005 deal, right? And yet, it still happened. What do you think now about the so-called secret weapon of Malacañang, a familiar friend to China, now still in the mix? And of course, we're talking about former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo. She's been present in every single meeting. As we said, the president now calls her the secret weapon. What do you think about the influence that she has on future deals? And what concerns might you have about this influence that the former president has over the incumbent, only regarding this, the possible joint explorations with China? Go ahead, Teddy.
That's actually a scary prospect because Gloria Macapagal Arroyo was president when the JMSU was signed. She was also president when the NBN-ZTE was signed, when the North Rail project was signed, when the agreement allowing China to use millions of hectares of Philippine agricultural land was signed. So if this is the secret weapon, then we are alarmed that she might be pushing the same things that she pushed in during her presidency. And precisely this Supreme Court ruling tells us that these kinds of agreements that she entered into are unconstitutional. And maybe the government or President Marcos should rethink his idea that GMA is the secret weapon. She might be China's secret weapon, but definitely she's not the Philippines' secret weapon.
Hmm. If the agreements, future agreements, push through without this ruling being the guiding principle, what scenario awaits the Philippines?
Well, even without this ruling, we have the constitution. In fact, President Arroyo stopped the JMSU when we filed this petition in the Supreme Court. So even without that ruling, the constitution is there. It is a strong deterrent, supposedly, to these kinds of agreements. Mm-hmm. So it will be a struggle, a continuing struggle. But what is good is that the Supreme Court has already come out. And this is a very big weapon that we might use against efforts to sell out our economic zone, our sovereignty in the West Philippine Sea. Mm.
Teddy, I think it's common knowledge, right, that any expiration, joint or otherwise, would greatly benefit the country. But we have these things that we have to contend with. So the question now is, what yes. is the alternative in your eyes? What's the alternative here? How can we possibly go and go deeper into that expiration without necessarily compromising the Constitution?
Well, it has been done before. Remember the Malampaya natural gas project involved big foreign entities. You had Shell there, you had Chevron there. But government was able to find a way to get around the constitutional provisions. Mm. But one factor there is that because Shell and Chevron had no claim, territorial claim over Malampaya, the complication now is that China has a territorial claim. Mm. So it will not be as easy to go around these provisions because China herself will say that these provisions will not be acceptable. Mm. But the only alternative really is to follow the constitution and to ensure that if there will be any exploration, government should have a big stake. It should be the controlling stake. It should be the supervising entity. And that any other private entity should be 60% owned by Filipinos. Mm. I mean, you know, there is a way, I think, to do that. Mm-hmm. And it will depend now on the creativity and the willingness of both parties to really explore for the benefit of both countries. Yeah. The biggest stumbling block there is China's claim that it's their territory.
Mm-hmm. Which brings us to the next point. There has been an idea that is floated that maybe there should be a clause there that says that China recognizes that there is a dispute. But even with that, it recognizes as well that it's not theirs, which is counter to what they're saying.
Well, China can say say anything it wants. As long as if there will be Chinese interest in the exploration, it is within the context of 60-40 relationship. If there will be any private entity that will enter into exploration, mm-hmm. and that government should have supervision over the project. Mm-hmm. As long as that is followed, I think China can make all its claims and the Filipinos will likewise make all its claims. Mm. But the letter of the constitution should be followed.
Mm. All right. Before we let you go, I mean, this obviously is not over yet. Nery Colmenares said in the statement, it's a major victory, but the battle is not over. People are closely following this. People want to know what's the end game here for both countries. And as we do that, what do you think should the citizenry look out for? As this story continues to develop, what are we looking at? What should we look at here?
Habol ko lang, Carmina. Those alternatives, it's not just China who might be interested in the West Philippine Sea. You know, in the past, we had the Dutch firms, mm-hmm. American firms involved in the Malampaya project. Mm-hmm. So we can partner with any other country that has no claim over the West Philippine Sea. I mean, I think Malaysia would be interested. Our neighbors in ASEAN would probably be interested. Even Vietnam, probably. You have other countries who would like to get a crack at the rich natural gas and oil resources in that area. So we're not really bound or limited to China as the choice. But of course, easier said than done. Mm-hmm. No?
Why is it easier said than done?
Because China has a very overpowering presence in that area. Mm-hmm. And anyone other than China who would like to explore that area would have to contend with that.
Right.
So I think this will be the big considerations.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, as a people, we should really just assert our rights over the West Philippine Sea. There's no way, other way to do it. It might not be resolved in 10 or 15 or even 20 years, but this is a long game. This is for the long haul.
Mm-mm.
And
so anong kailangan bantayan? Yeah, movement in the House of Representatives? The move
the cha-cha is one, mm-hmm. I think. Because if they amend the cha-cha, the constitution to allow China to take over the West Philippine Sea or to be the dominant majority owner of any exploration activities in the West Philippine Sea, that would really be a sellout. And Congress would be complicit in that if they amend the Constitution.
Mm. What about the movements of former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo? Should that be watched carefully as well?
Of course. But, she's a secret. So we might not be able to know exactly her role, but I think transparency dictates that if she has any role, considering that one of her pet projects with China has already been declared unconstitutional, there should be more transparency into her role in whatever negotiations there are between the Marcos administration and China.
All right, we're going to have to leave it at that. Teddy Casino there, National Council Member of Bayan. Thanks a lot, Teddy, for joining us today. Really
thanks,
appreciate
Carmina.
It.
Thanks, Carmina. Good afternoon.
Take care. Right, from there, we're going to take a quick break. Up ahead, transport regulators order Grab Philippines to explain its fare computation mechanism following complaints of alleged surge charging and high base fares. Dateline Philippines will be right back. Stay with us here on ANC. And we're back. We're still with Dateline Philippines here on ANC. Here's another look at our headlines this noon. Malacañang pushing back against the claim of resigned Defense Department OIC about the leadership change in the armed forces. The High Court junks a 2005 agreement of the Philippines, China, and Vietnam for a joint marine seismic undertaking in the South China Sea. One of the petitioners, Bayan's Teddy Casino, said the ruling now becomes more relevant amid a renewed interest between Manila and Beijing for oil exploration. The World Bank slashes its growth forecast, warning the global economy is dangerously close to recession. And the low-pressure area off Surigao City bringing rains to the southern part of the Philippines. Back with more news. The Philippines' acting health secretary stresses the significance of extending the state of calamity declaration despite the improving COVID situation in the country. Rafael Bosano reports.
Despite the emergence of new Omicron subvariants in different parts of the world, the COVID-19 situation in the Philippines continues to improve. Even if cases have seen a slight increase in the past months, data from the Philippine Health Department show that the trend continues to plateau, if not decline. But the decline has been observed to slow among those being admitted for severe forms of the disease. Latest projections by the agency show that cases may no longer breach 1,000 by mid-February.
If ever minimum public health standards to decline, tapos tuloy-tuloy ang pasok ng mga variants na highly evasive and highly transmissible, we would see up hanggang mga 730 cases by February 15. So hanggang ganung level lang ang nakikita ng projections natin ngayon.
The continuously manageable situation in the Philippines was cited by President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. as to why he is, quote, very hesitant to extend the country's state of calamity. Verhera says that while they will heed the president's decision, the extension of the state of calamity remains significant.
Hindi rin naman lang yung vaccination natin ang pinag-uusapan. We're talking about the other conditions no, nakapasok sa state of calamity, katulad ng mga tax exemptions natin when we procure for these vaccines and other commodities that we need for COVID-19 response. Na andyan din kasi yung health emergency allowance sa mga healthcare workers natin, which is also anchored on the state of calamity. So it is still significant for us.
The agency declined to name the countries that have signified their intention to donate bivalent vaccines to the Philippines as negotiations are ongoing. They assure that the quantity will be enough for those identified to receive them first. Meanwhile, Verhera says that the Bureau of Quarantine continues to monitor those coming into the Philippines. As a matter of fact, new samples have been sent to the Philippine Genome Center to undergo sequencing. Results of genome sequencing among samples of the 8 Filipino travelers from China who tested positive for COVID in the country are also set to be released in the coming days. Rafael Bosano, ABS-CBN News.
China retaliates against South Korea and Japan's travel curbs on its citizens. Beijing suspended the issuance of short-term visas to South Korean and Japanese travelers. It says the measures will be adjusted if Seoul and Tokyo lift what it calls discriminatory restrictions on China. South Korea and Japan are among the long list of nations that tighten border measures against travelers from China due to its new COVID outbreak. Back at home, advocacy groups band together to help onion farmers sell their produce at competitive prices. This comes as government announced plans to import onions to stabilize prices. Adrian Ayalin gives us details.
1,700 kilograms of yellow or white onions from farmers of Bayambang, Pangasinan were brought by the group Rise Up to the Immaculate Heart of Mary Parish in Quezon City. Bought by Rise Up at 375 pesos per kilogram from farmers, the onions were then repacked by Bayanihang Marikenyo at Marikenya volunteers, which sold the produce at 400 pesos per kilo to sure buyers who paid in advance.
Brinage namin directly yung farmers sa consumers, pero magagawa mo lang to if you have a community working together as a team. So teamwork talaga tong nangyari na to. So ito yung tinatawag natin solidarity purchase.
Napakamahal ng retail price pero hindi naman nakikinabang po yung mga farmers natin. So talagang may disconnect po, may gap between dun sa supply chain.
The initiative, which they call Solidarity Purchase, was an offshoot of a simple social media rant, which turned into positive action by private individuals as the government scrambles for solutions to the onion problem. The Solidarity Buy coincided with the announcement of the Department of Agriculture that an importation clearance for 21,000 metric tons of onions was issued to licensed importers. Arrival of shipments should be on or before January 27th. The clearance, dated January 6th and signed by Undersecretary Domingo Panganiba, stabilized
pressure ng farm gate. Eh kung kahit bababaan mo pa yung farm gate to the level of the 250 na sinet natin nung from December 28 to January 7, wala rin sa level na yon.
But Rise Up and Onion farmers still expressed concern and appealed to the DA to go easy on their importation plans. The DA meantime assured it's looking into cartels supposedly manipulating the prices of onions brought up by Senator Cynthia Villar, aside from the persistent issue of smuggling.
Tingnan natin kung sino ang nakakonsign dito sa mga smuggled na to at sa kasino rin ang namimili doon na nag-highest bidder doon sa mga taniman ng sibuyas. Baka isang tao lang din yan.
Iba pa yung smuggling, yung binibigyan na import permit.
Yes,
tapos trader na may control mga supplies galing sa farmer, tapos sila din yung importer, tapos nakokontrol nila yung supply, nakikreate nila yung artificial demand para okay. Maipagbigyan nila ng mahal yung kanilang produkto.
The DA also said it is open to an investigation by the ombudsman on the purchase of expensive onions by the Food Terminal Incorporated and sold at a lower price in Kadiwa stores run by the government. At the Kadiwa store outside the DA compound, onions are still sold at 170 pesos per kilo. But people are complaining of the long queue. In ordinary markets such as this one in Quezon City, onions are still sold at around 550 pesos per kilo. Adrian Ayalin, ABS-CBN News.
The amount of smuggled onions seized by the Bureau of Customs in 2022 hits 500 to 600 million pesos. BOC spokesperson Arnaldo de la Torre Jr. assures the public the agency is stepping up efforts to crack down on the illegal importation of the vegetable. De la Torre also says investigations into those who were involved in the smuggling of onions are ongoing.
Na yung proseso po ng pag-seize o ng forfeiture proceeding po ay ongoing po dito sa Bureau of Customs. Yung mga ibang nahuli na ho natin, particular po itong like for dito po sa Port of Manila na report na halagang 2 milyong halaga ng sibuyas po at yung pong iba pa po na nauna ng na kumpiska natin, ito po ay nag-undergo ng investigation at kung saan yung pong mga commodities or agriculture products na ating nasamsam po ay nasubject po ito ng warrant of seizure and detention. Mm. At after hearing po ng mga ito, ito po ay agad nating isinusumite sa Department of Justice.
A vegetable producers group says the Philippine government should not push through with its plan to import onions. Eric Alvarez, board director of a producers cooperative in Nueva Ecija, says it's already too late for this, since the harvest of onions by local farmers would have already been done by the time the imported ones arrive. He adds, government may also reduce the volume of the import order.
Base po sa sinabi ng DA, darating ng ang last dating po na imported is January 27. Mm. So ibig sabihin po, January 27 onward, noon pa lang po maibebenta yung huling dating na imported.
Right.
Eh yung time po na yun, yun na po ang karamihan ng ani ng sibuyas ng mga magsasaka dito po sa atin sa Pilipinas. Sa importation kasi, ang unang-unang makikinabang po dito, importer. Mm-hmm. Yung pong consumer natin, hindi rin po ganong makikinabang kasi baka po ang gawin ng importer, yung price po ng imported na sibuyas, ididikit lang po sa price ng local. Mm-hmm. Eh di sila lang po ang kikita.
Meanwhile, a House lawmaker is seeking an investigation into an alleged onion cartel. Marikina Representative Stella Kimbo wants to know why prices of red onions have risen to over 700 pesos per kilo compared to just 220 pesos per kilo in the same period last year. She notes concerns over the possible hoarding of onions to jack up its price had been raised as early as August last year. The Land Transportation Franchising and Regulatory Board gives Grab Philippines 2 days to explain its fare computation mechanism. That's after the ride-hailing firm failed to sufficiently justify its pricing amid complaints over alleged surge charging and high base fares. Surge charging is the additional amount the company charges to passengers during peak hours. The LTFRB warns of penalties if Grab is proven to have committed violations.
Dalawang year yun, then maglalabas na ng resolution ng board. Definitely, pagka mayroong resolution ng board, mayroong supporting na mga next step ang board sigurado. Definitely, the board can impose fines on the TNCs.
The Commission on Elections opened satellite registration sites in jails, allowing inmates to vote in the village and youth council polls. Michael Deliso now joins us for more. Mike, go ahead.
Hi, Carmina. Good afternoon. Well, the Commission on Elections, or COMELEC, on Wednesday held simultaneous special satellite registrations at detention facilities in the country, allowing persons deprived of liberty, or PDLs, to vote for the national and local polls. At least 2,084 PDLs at the New Bilibid prison transferred their registration in Muntinlupa City to vote for the 2023 Barangay and Pamunuan Kabataan elections. Among who registered was former Army General Jovito Palparan, convicted of kidnapping and serious illegal detention over the 2007 disappearance of student activist Karen Empeño and Sherlyn Cadapan. He refused to be interviewed. There will be two modes available for PDL voting. One is the special voting centers in a detention facility, and if the detainee is a registered voter of another city or municipality, or in case there is no established special voting center in the detention facility, the detainee may be escorted to the regular voting center where he or she is registered.
Kung darating na halala, ito yung unang pagkakataon matapos ang desisyon ng Korte Suprema na makakapagparehistro tayo at makakapagpaboto muli tayo ng ating mga PDLs. Sila rin bilang mga mamamayan ng ating bansa ay may karapatan na makapaghalal ng kanilang napipisin na mga leader.
The Supreme Court in 2002 lifted the temporary standing order it issued in 2016 that stopped the whole body from implementing its Resolution 9371 or the rules and regulations on detainee registration and voting. Apart from the Libid, the special satellite registrations were also simultaneously conducted at prison facilities in Mandaluyong City and provinces of Leyte, Davao, Zamboanga, Palawan, and Occidental Mindoro. Back to you, Camina.
Thanks a lot, Michael Deliso. They're joining us on the line. We're going to take a quick break now. Still ahead, the World Bank warns of a looming global recession. More on that when we come back. You're watching Dateline Philippines here on ANC. World News, Australian Cardinal George Pell, an influential figure of the Catholic Church, has died at 81 years old. A church official confirmed Pell died of complications related to a hip surgery on Tuesday. From his humble beginnings in Australia, he climbed to the ranks to become Pope Francis's right-hand man. But his name was tainted after he was convicted of molesting two choir boys in the 90s while he was still Archbishop of Melbourne. Pell was cleared of sexual abuse in 2020, allowing him to walk free after 13 months in prison. He had been the most senior figure accused in the global sex abuse scandal that has rocked the Roman Catholic Church. U.S. President Joe Biden says he is unaware of the contents of classified documents found in his former private office. The files during Biden's time as vice president have been turned over to the National Archives. Biden expressed his surprise at their discovery, but vowed full cooperation with the investigation. Meanwhile, a House Republican leader wants a damage assessment of the discovery of the documents. Representative Mike Turner says Biden may have violated the Espionage Act and Presidential Records Act. Republicans have just taken control of the House and have vowed to launch widespread investigations into Biden's administration. The World Bank slashes its growth forecast as it warns the global economy is dangerously close to recession. In its latest report, the international lender cut its 2023 growth projection for the world economy by nearly half to 1.7%. That is the lowest growth rate in the past three decades, only overshadowed by the 2009 and 2020 global recessions. It cites the continued risks of high inflation, rising interest rates, and Russia's invasion of Ukraine. It warns any additional shocks could be particularly devastating for emerging and developing economies. The bank says immediate policy action is needed to bolster growth and investment.
Debt problem becomes even larger in an environment you have weak growth and higher interest rates. The problem is larger in frontier markets, in low-income countries, a larger fraction of them are already in debt distress or about to fall into debt distress. If financing conditions get tighter, we will likely see more debt crisis this year.
For the Philippines, the World Bank slashed its 2023 growth forecast by 0.2 points, citing broad-based weakness in the Asia-Pacific region. The Philippines should continue preparing for the worst amid lingering economic challenges. That appeal coming from the Financial Stability Coordination Council as it released a report detailing the risks that the Philippines faced in 2022. These include inflation, tightening of monetary policy, and climate change. To ensure continued financial stability, the group, chaired by Central Bank Governor Felipe Medalla, called for better development of the equities market and better regulation of industries. As for efforts to address inflation, Medalla says the central bank can be more focused on tackling the high consumer price index now that the peso is beginning to strengthen against the U.S. dollar.
Maybe, kasi baka tapos na yung strong dollar period. We may not be as concerned about the interest rate differential as much as we were. Kasi dyan, a rule of thumb is between 1 and 1.5% yung interest rate differential for a stronger peso. But but who knows, because the dollar is now, if the dollar is no longer as supercharged as it is, and the policy rate changes in the U.S. will no longer be, 4.75 in a row?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So yeah. Then maybe we'll be a little bit more back to normal. That we are more like a standard inflation targeting central bank.
Over now to the awards season in Hollywood. Angela Bassett foils the Golden Globe bid of her very own Dolly De Leon as she beats an impressive list of nominees for the Best Supporting Acting Prize. Best Supporting Actress Prize. Let's get a wrap of the big winners in this year's Golden Globes. Former North America Bureau correspondent Steve Angeles. Steve, good afternoon from Manila.
Good evening, Carmina. The 80th Golden Globes are in the books, and Filipina actress Dolly De Leon did not bring home the Best Supporting Actress Award, with Wakanda Forever's Angela Bassett bringing home the Golden Globe. De Leon is still in the running for an Oscar Award and is set to accept her LA Film Critics' Choice Award later this week. Everything Everywhere All at Once scored two of the biggest awards, with Michelle Yeoh winning Best Actress and Kei Hoi Kwan getting the Globe for Best Supporting Actor. Hard to believe this is actually Michelle Yeoh's first ever Golden Globe. In other categories, Colin Farrell took Best Actor in a Musical or Comedy for Banshees of Inisherin. Austin Butler took home Best Actor in a Drama Movie for his role as Elvis, as Cate Blanchett won for Tar. Steven Spielberg won Best Director for The Fablemans, which also took home Best Drama Motion Picture. In television, Zendaya and Quinta Brunson took home their respective Best Actress categories. Abbott Elementary, which stars Brunson, was the Best Musical or Comedy Show, while House of the Dragon won for Best Drama Series. Jeremy Allen White and Kevin Costner brought home the Best Actor Awards for television. And Eddie Murphy received the Cecil B. DeMille Award for his lifetime of work, while producer Ryan Burnett was given the Carol Burnett Award. Carmina?
Thanks a lot. Steve Angeles there joining us live from LA. Thanks, Steve. Well, switching gears now, a Vietnamese pho restaurant takes a huge bite out of the food scene in the Middle East, proving to be a popular destination among diners in Abu Dhabi. Let's take a look.
Vietnamese pho restaurant has become a popular food destination in Abu Dhabi, United Arab Emirates. There are many Vietnamese traditional foods in the menu to introduce to international customers. This is an appealing feature that draws customers to the restaurant.
Those are delicious. I also love the beef bun, the beef noodle soup. It's so tasty.
Yeah, we always come here to eat. I introduced to many friends, many other nationalities. I introduced to them. They came and tried their love. And also I put the photos I put into the Google. And the review was 30,000 people thumbs up.
Vietnamese cuisines combine together in a traditional setting with conical hats, Hoi An lanterns, or simple palm roofs. Every diner is now pulled closer to Vietnam traditions.
Vietnamese traditional meal has always been my favorite, especially at this restaurant. The chef also cooks excellently. That makes me feel as if I'm in Vietnam.
Vietnamese cuisine is becoming increasingly popular. My restaurant attracts diners who have never eaten Vietnamese food before. Since I am in touch with clients daily, I understand that many consumers want to try Vietnamese cuisine. That encourages me to open another restaurants. Visitors can see Vietnamese features in every corner of this restaurants. Cuisine has helped Vietnam become more connected and widespread in the Middle East.
Contestants for the 71st Miss Universe pageant are in the thick of preparations for the preliminary events. Our very own Diane Castillejo gives us the latest from New Orleans in Louisiana.
Beauty, poise, and grace fill the New Orleans Convention Center as candidates prepared for Miss Universe 2022. Miss Philippines Celeste Cortesi has been consistent in her styling, wearing a white suit and black stilettos.
Every morning, I am grateful that I'm here right now. I am representing the Philippines, and I really cannot wait for the grand night.
And your mom's coming, and your boyfriend.
Yes, I cannot wait.
Filipina beauty shone bright when Phil-Italian Celeste and Phil-Am Miss USA Arbony Gabriel got together for a photo op.
I'm feeling good, well-rested.
New Orleans is a proud host for Miss Universe, and the NOLA mayor officially welcomed the candidates from all over the world.
As the first woman elected mayor to this great city in its 300-year history, to be on this stage surrounded by strong, beautiful women representing the globe.
In her last few days as Miss Universe 2021, reigning queen from India, Arna Sandhu, continues to inspire.
I don't want to really say goodbye, but I know it's that time that the next girl needs to be crowned. So I'm excited for the successor. I really want to welcome her, and I just want to tell her that, you know, you were chosen for a reason, so just be yourself.
This batch of 84 candidates are once again complete since the return of Miss Curacao, Gabriela Dos Santos, quarantined for several days before finally testing negative for COVID-19. This 20-year-old model and life coach is also one of the preliminary favorites.
In my room, I was just trying to stay positive. I read a lot. I did my exercises. I maintained my diet. Miss Universe was providing me with food and vitamins every day, three times a day. So I was just maintaining a positive energy and meditating and just affirming that I'll be out there.
The long hours of rehearsals every day have tested the stamina of the girls, who are the stars of the shows.
The rehearsals was fun. We're doing a lot of pretty interesting things that I don't think we've seen before on a Miss Universe stage. So you guys are in for a surprise. I think you're going to like this year's number.
Are you practicing the opening number, or what part of the show is it?
Yeah, it's like part of the opening, like a little dance, and it's more like a party, like clapping our hands and, yes, getting some energy.
Today, I'm here with the pretty girl. It's like all pretty girl in here, and I'm so excited and I'm so happy. So please support me, and thank you for your support from Thai people and Philippine fans.
All candidates have also been preparing for the crucial closed-door interview, which is one of the bases for the judges to select the semi-finalists.
How about your Q&A? Are you still training?
Yes, sometimes I do, whenever I have time to train with my team, or else I just read.
Yeah,
my notes.
The interview with the judges, it was the most nervous thing that I was feeling. But now, I don't know, I'm like doing every day with so much passion.
I take that pressure and I turn it into fuel and wanting to be the best that I can, do the best work that I can so Puerto Rico can feel proud.
Oh, you feel confident now, huh?
Yes, I feel confident, and I like be myself every time in here.
Yeah.
I'm happy every moment. That I'm so happy and I'm so excited.
Miss Universe is looking for a total package with a purpose-driven advocacy.
So I'm looking forward to see who the new person is and see what she's passionate about and how the organization can back her up. I'd like to see a woman with a voice that is very centered and knows who she is, regardless of all the craziness that goes on around her.
Candidates really need to bring their A game as they prepare for the closed-door interview, the preliminary competition, and the national costume show, all happening in the next few days. Saturday night in the U.S., Sunday morning in the Philippines is coronation finals, where Arnaz Sandu will pass her crown to the next queen. Diane Castillejo, ABS-CBN News, New Orleans, Louisiana.
Well, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. leads the distribution of various government assistance to victims of heavy rains and flash floods in Hingoog City in Misamis Oriental. Pia Gutierrez now joins us with details. Pia, what more can you tell us?
Yes, Carmina, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. on Wednesday visited the provinces of Misamis Occidental and Misamis Oriental as heavy rains and flooding continue to batter the northern Mindanao provinces. According to the Presidential Communications Office, the plane carrying the president made three landing attempts before touching down at the Ozamiz City Airport earlier this morning. The president, accompanied by Secretary of National Defense Carlito Galvez, then proceeded to conduct a briefing with Misamis Occidental Governor Henry O. Aminal at the airport instead of Oroquete City as originally planned due to inclement weather. However, Carmina, heavy rains prevented the president from doing an ocular inspection over Oroquete City to see the extent of the devastation. The president told local officials there that he had wanted to visit the affected areas in northern Mindanao, but he was hindered by continuing severe weather. After the briefing, the president proceeded to distribute relief goods in Tutela, Misamis Occidental. According to Malacanang, some 55.81 million pesos worth of financial assistance from the DSWD has been distributed to 11,133 beneficiaries in Misamis Occidental and Misamis Oriental. Of the figure, some 8.67 million was provided to 1,733 beneficiaries in Oroquete City. As you said, the president also distributed relief assistance to residents in Himoog City. He proceeded there right after going to Misamis Occidental. And as of this moment, Carmina, the president is being briefed by local officials in Himoog City on the situation in the area. Carmina.
Thanks a lot. Pia Gutierrez there joining us on the line. And that'll do it for today. Thanks for joining us. I'm Carmina Constantino. If you want to revisit today's episode, you can play back this newscast on ANC's YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe. Keep it here on the News Channel.